So thank you very much. So yesterday I told you about fundamental constants and the role they play in the laws of physics. What I would like today to try to explain to you is that there have been a tremendous work during the past 15 years about trying to understand how different the constant may be in our own observable universe. And I think it's very important because we have been discussing about this anthropic domain. Actually, it will show you how difficult it is in practice to delimitate this, I mean, to understand what is the size of these anthropic domains. And you will show that even with physics that we think is established physics, there are huge difficulties. So what I will do is that I will first tell you what we are doing when we want to set constraints, what is the way we proceed, and then I will take a series of examples. So I don't want to go in all the technical details because each of these one is like very technical, but I will try to show you what you have to know, what you have to observe, and how you, the kind of approximation you have to make. And also it will give you a picture about what we know about the fundamental constant in our own observable universe. And this will go from Big Bang nucleosynthesis, which is basically 1 second after the Big Bang, to today in the laboratory with atomic clocks. So we will spend this almost 14 giga years of history of our own universe, and we will get constraints on the variation of fundamental constant on this time scale. And this is important because, as I said before, all these constraints, as long as we see no variation of the fundamental constant, these give larger credence to general relativity, I mean, at least in the Einstein equivalence principle. So it's very important because all what we infer concerning the dark matter, dark energy, assumes the validity of general relativity. If for any reason we see some violation of this, then we know that our extrapolations of the law of physics is not correct. So which means that we have to go back and all the argumentation we have about maybe the cosmological constant or anything that would motivate a multiverse, you have to redo it from the beginning. So it's very important for us to increase the domain of validity of the laws of physics that we are using in this inference. So this is what I will try to explain now. So usually when you have a physical system, let's say you want to analyze a star, what you do, you will do a physical model of the star, but in this physical modeling, you will put the numbers, if you do a numerical code to compute what is the stellar evolution of this particular star, you will say, okay, the value of the constant of gravitation is the same as the one we have measured here in the laboratory, the mass of the particle are the same, so this number will be fixed. And then you run your simulation and you will say something about the size of the stars, the luminosity of the stars, the radius of the star, the physical parameter of these objects. So here what we want to do is to have some observables. They will depend on this external parameter, like the temperature of the system. But what we want to do now is that we also want to measure the fundamental constant from the evolution and the observation of this system. So we will not assume that these numbers are given by the numbers we measure here today in the solar system. So in order to know which system we can consider, we would like to find system for which first we really understand the way the system is working so that we can control these external parameters. And then what we want to do is to have system which, if you make a slight modification of some fundamental constant, it has a huge effect on these observables. So basically this will be characterized by what I call this kappa, which is the sensitivity of the change of the output of your system for a small variation of these parameters. Okay, so this is the kind of system, this is the way we will select the most sensitive system. Most of the systems in physics, they are slightly dependent on the value of the fundamental constant. You can change them by 1% and your system will change by 1 or 2% or less. So it will be like a sensitivity of order 1. We will look for systems which have huge sensitivity. These parameters GK, they are which I call primary physical parameters, they may not be fundamental constant. For instance, it could be the binding energy of some nuclei. It could be some resonance energy of some nuclear interactions. In principle, this physical parameter, I should be able to express them in terms of the fundamental parameters, the 23 parameters I described in my first lectures. So there will be the next step would be to express these physical parameters in terms of the fundamental constant, and you will get numbers here. And I will show you that getting this number is actually a very difficult task, and there are open questions in physics today in the way to determine these numbers. Let us make a summary of the system that we will talk about. So this is our past light cone, so we are sitting here, this is our world line in space-time, so this is basically time and space, and this is the photons that we are observing are traveling on this null hypersurface, and Z is the redshift, so the larger Z, the further in space you are, then equal infinity would be the Big Bang singularity. So today in the laboratory here in the solar system, we can use atomic clocks and compare atomic clocks. Then we have several observables in the solar system. I will describe the Oklo phenomena. I won't talk about meteorite dating, but they give constraints on our world line at a redshift of 0.43, which is, I mean, start to be comparable with some astrophysical observations. Then we have a series of observations on our past light cone, and mainly coming from quasar absorption spectra. I will try to explain what are these spectra and how we use them to put constraints. And then if we go further, the two most important cosmological observations, which are used to set constraints on all cosmological models, are the cosmic microwave background and Big Bang nucleosynthesis. So they come to a redshift of 1,000 and 10 to the 8, which is basically from 1 second to a couple of minutes after the Big Bang, and about 300,000 years after the Big Bang. So you see, we have a huge time scale, and it spans different region in our space-time volume. So as long as observation is concerned, the only thing we can measure is redshift. We cannot measure time. And if we want to talk in terms of time, what we need to do is we need to use a cosmological model. You don't read the number, it's just to say that if I want to know what is the look-back time as a function of redshift, I have to assume a series of numbers. I need to know what is the curvature of space. I need to know what is the value of the cosmological constant, the Hubble parameters. And this is coming from fit to some other cosmological parameters. So here is what we would get for the look-back time as a function of the redshift. And this is where these different observations lie in this plot. So basically, it will tell you that this is in gigahertz, that the Oklo phenomena is about two gigahertz ago, and that quasar absorption spectra give information up to, let's say, 12 gigahertz ago. So it just gives you an information about the time scales that aren't involved. But remind that this conversion between redshift, which we observe, and time may change by slightly if we change the value of the cosmological parameters. So now we have what kind of physics is involved in these different observations. So here is a list of the systems that I have described in these space-time diagrams. And we have different kind of observables. So if I use atomic clock, I will compare two atomic clocks, so I will have clock rates. And then I can ask myself, what are the constants that on which this observable depends? And for atomic clocks, basically, this will be the fine structure constant. Mu will be the ratio between mass of the electron and mass of the proton. And the J here are the so-called geomagnetic factors. And basically, all the observations can be interpreted in terms of these three parameters. So you see, alpha is a fundamental constant. It appears in our fundamental action. Mu is a ratio of two masses, so electron and proton. The electron is a fundamental particle. The proton is not a fundamental particle. The proton is made of quarks. So if I want to express mu in terms of the parameters of the theoretical Lagrangian, I have to be able to compute the mass of the proton in terms of the mass of the quark and the strong energy, binding energy, and so on. And this is a very difficult computation. The same is true for the geomagnetic factors. Quasar absorption spectra are almost the same. What we are able to do is, because light is traveling through the universe, we are able to get paleospectra and compare these spectra to the spectra today. So basically, this is the same technique where one of the clock is very far from us, so in our past. But because we are doing astrophysics and the two clocks are not just sitting close to each other, the interpretation of this spectra will depend on many physical properties of the cloud which absorb light, and that I will describe to you. Then we have Oklo phenomena, which is a very nice model, and basically it will depend on some resonance energy of a nuclear reaction. But again, to interpret this data, you will need to make a geophysical model of this reactor. And for cosmic microwave and Big Bang nucleosynthesis, this is even more complicated, because the interpretation will depend on all the cosmological parameters. So you will have to add this new parameter, like the fine structure constant, this new parameter. And for BBN, there is a long list, and I will try to explain you why, to the standard cosmological parameters. So it makes that while you may have a very high accuracy on this parameter with atomic clock, the accuracy will decrease because you will need to have more and more information about the way your cosmos is behaving. Okay, so let us start by atomic clocks. So what you do is you will take two atomic clocks. So an atomic clock is basically an atom, and you have transitions, and these transitions they have specific frequencies, or the photons which are emitted have specific energy, and this is the kind of thing that we can compute. This is quantum electrodynamics. So the one for which you can do analytic, you can get analytic results, is the hydrogen atom. This is in many textbooks in quantum physics, and you have optical transitions, so they depend mostly on the Rydberg constant, and then you have fine structure, which depends also on the fine structure constant squared. And then you have some splitting of red due to the what we call the hyperfine structure, which is the coupling between the spin of the nuclei and the spin of the electrons. And this will also depend on this ratio between the mass of the electron and mass of the proton. So you see on the example of the hydrogen atom, you see that all the constants which appear here are the fine structure constant and the geomagnetic factor and this mu parameter. But now if you take two lines, the ratio of two lines will not depend on the Rydberg constant. So what you will try to do is to compare two clocks with different transitions, because they will have different dependence in these parameters. So when you go from a general atom, the computation is much more difficult. Usually what you need to do is to solve these quantum electrodynamic equations for many electron systems, so you cannot do that analytical. You have to resort on some n-body simulations, and you will get general formula for which the frequency of an hyperfine structure or an electronic transition will depend on the fundamental constant G, alpha, and mu, but you will have this parameter which will depend on the fine structure constant or even on the charge of the nuclei that you are considering. And these numbers, they can be computed. So here is how this number depend on the change of the fine structure constant. And here I made a list of the transitions that we have been considered for atomic clocks in the lab today, and the computation of the sensitivity parameters for this quantities. So then what you do is you take two different clocks based on different nuclei, different transitions, and because these parameters will be different, you will try to see whether they keep time in the same way. Remember, in my first lecture, I explained to you that one way to test for the equivalence principle, equality between inertial mass and gravitational mass, was to take two pendulums and see whether they swing with the same pulsation. So this is exactly the same. These were two clocks, and we are doing the same with atomic clocks. So here is a list of what has been achieved today. So we have two clocks, clock one and clock two. For reasons, as I told you yesterday, the second is defined with respect to a transition in cesium. So it means that in any laboratory doing metrology, they have cesium clocks. They need to have this cesium clock just to realize a second. So what people usually do is to compare different clocks to the cesium. And this is, this should be here. So this is the rate of change of the frequency of these two transitions between clock one and clock two. So we are using rubidium clock with mercury, ytterbium, strontium. And you see that the constraint, so this is the evolution with year, has gone from something close to 10 to the minus 15 to 10 to the minus 16 to 10 to the minus 17 based on the comparison of clocks based on transition in aluminium and mercury. So you see today we see that this combination of the constant is very constrained. So you see for each clock we have a different combination between the geomagnetic factor of the nuclei of the different atoms, this mu parameter, and the fine structure constant. So now these constraints tell you that alpha cannot vary by more than a fraction of 10 to the minus 17 on a time scale of a year, which is something which is very impressive. So now we'd like to disintegrate this thing. And if you want to relate this to variation in the fundamental constant, you have to be able to compute the geomagnetic factor here. And I will try to explain how to do that. I will not do the computation for you, it's too complicated. I did that with two of my collaborators, Keith Olive and Feng Luo. So the first step is to express the geomagnetic factor of the nuclei in terms of the geomagnetic factor of the proton. Okay, and that you can do in different models. In the simplest model, which is called the Schett model, you just get these numbers. It's just the way you stack the neutron and the protons inside your nuclei. So it means that in the end, the rate of change of the frequency of the two clocks can be related to a variation of the geomagnetic factor, the mu parameter, and the alpha parameter. And what is interesting here is that if you go back to these constraints, you will see that this clock just depends on alpha alone. So you can use this one to set a constraint on alpha, and then you can use these things to put a an independent constraint on the two other parameters, which is the variation of the gyromagnetic factor of the proton and the variation of this mu parameter, mass of the electron over mass of the proton. And you see that each of these parameters should not vary by more than some number times 10 to the minus 16 per year. So now you would like to express this GP and this mu, they are not, they are constant, but they are not fundamental constant. I have to express this quantity in terms of other parameters. And so this is what we have tried to do. And if you go, so you have to go to the theory of QCD, quantum chromodynamics, and then you can express how the geomagnetic factor of the proton depends on the mass of the quark, U, D, and strange quark. But also, this term is coming from the strong energy binding energy. You do the same for the mass of the proton, and you have different numbers here that you are able to compute. The problem is that if you go to discuss with specialists of quantum chromodynamics and you ask them what is these numbers, you will get various answers. Because we it's very difficult to relate the fundamental physics of quarks to nuclear physics. And people are using different approximation, numerical simulation. And actually, these numbers, they are not very well known. So if you compute this number, you will see that typically they can vary by two order of magnitudes. I mean, the sensitivity in the interpretation can vary by two order of magnitude. So you have a theoretical indeterminacy just because while in theory, you know that the link exists, in practice, it's very difficult to resolve this equation. The system is too complex, so we don't know how to do better than that. So this is well-known physics, you know, how to compute the mass of the proton in terms of the mass of the different quark and the strong energy, binding energy, and we don't know actually how to do it in practice to a high accuracy. Okay, so now we want to do the same with quasars. So the quasar is not important, it's just a light. So what is important is that you have somewhere in the universe some very bright object, and that we observe this object from here on Earth, and the light is propagating in the universe. The universe is not empty, it has a lot of clouds everywhere. And so if the light coming from the quasar is going through the clouds, you have atoms, it can excite the atoms at specific frequency. These atoms will disexcite, but isotropically, which means that they will disexcite in all directions, which means that for the observer, you will see an absorption spectrum. So if you study this absorption spectra, you can have some ideas about the chemical composition of this cloud. And this is the way usually that these absorption spectra are used in astrophysics, is just to know something about the chemical composition of the interstellar medium or intergalactic medium. But now you know that if you are able to recognize these elements, you can ask yourself, okay, imagine that I have a doublet, it has the delta lambda here. Is this delta lambda the same as the one I will get from a reference spectrum here in the laboratory? What we know is that because of the expansion of the universe, every wavelengths are redshifted, but this is an achromatic effect. As I explained to you before, if I change the fundamental constant, the different line will change differently, so which means that I will have an achromatic effect. So you want to see whether you are able to detect an achromatic effect in this spectra when you compare them to spectra in the universe. So just to sketch what's happening, so this is the spectra of the quasars, the light emitted here. The light will propagate and go through different clouds here. So first the light cross the first cloud, you have some absorption, so you have some absorption line here. Then light is propagating to the second cloud. Everything is redshifted because of the expansion of the universe, and you have a new absorption, so you get something like that. And again, you propagate here, you have an achromatic redshifting and a new absorption, and so on and so on. So at the end, what you see is that you have this kind of absorption. So this is what is called the Lyman alpha forest. It's due for all the Lyman transition. And you also have other, at higher wavelengths, you have other transitions which are coming from the other elements and hydrogens. So we are looking for achromatic effects. So just to be sure what we are doing, we have two lines. The frequency between the difference of frequency between these two lines will depend on the fundamental constant, and this is in the laboratory. You see, this is the same lines in some objects. So you have a redshift here. So you should be able to from one line to compute the redshift. The question is whether the redshift determined by this line and this line give you the same number. If GR is 100% true, they should give you exactly the same redshift. If not, it means that there may be a small difference redshifting of the two lines, and this will reflect a variation of the fundamental constant between the time of the absorption and today. Okay, so the idea was proposed by Malcolm Savedov in the 50s, and he was using alkali doublets. So today we have a lot of transitions that can be used, and mostly because there are a lot of ultraviolet lines and they are redshifting into the optical band. So we use a lot of transitions, and I don't want to make a list of all this. We are starting also to use radio observation. There is one thing which I think is very important to have in mind, is that imagine that you want to measure a change of the fine structure constant of the order of 10 to the minus 5. This would correspond, if you take an object at a redshift 2, to a shift of 20 milliangstrom, okay? And such a shift, if you have a resolution of 40,000, which is the typical resolution of the Keck or VLT telescopes in Hawaii or Chile, correspond to 1/3 of the pixel. So basically, we are pushing the observation at the limit of what we can do. And I think this is also a very nice interaction between theory and observation, is that, of course, observers, they want to do that because they are trying to do the best they can, and they can use this kind of theoretical motivation to argue, oh, maybe we should get a resolution which is not 40,000, but 60,000. And we have projects like using extremely large telescope for which the goal is to measure this not at the level of 10 to the minus 5, but 10 to the minus 8. So it could be in 25 years from now. But you see, there is this interplay between having theoretical motivation to measure things and the fact that you actually can measure them by some technology, which makes that the field is a very lively field. And then you have many sources of uncertainties because, well, the absorption lines, they have profiles, and the distribution of the matter inside the cloud is not homogeneous. And you have to deconvolve many absorptions, and you can show that, in general, this is not a unique process. I mean, you can make many decompositions. So you have a lot of parameters to control. So the question is, which kind of element do you want to use? And for that, you will again rely on theoretical physics. You will say, OK, what kind of elements are really sensitive to a variation of the fine structure constant? So this is the sensitivity coefficient as a function of the wavelength. So here, you have different elements. So you see, you have lines, for instance, in iron 2, which will go to higher redshift if you vary the fine structure constant, while some other transition will go to lower redshift. So here you see the chromatic effect. You have some lines which are fairly insensitive to a change of the fine structure constant, like magnesium. So the idea would be to try to correlate these different transition, because we have a theoretical knowledge which tells you that if alpha is varying by, let's say, 10 to the minus 5, this line just should vary by 10 to the minus 5 in toward higher omega, while this one just should vary toward smaller omega. I mean, this, if you have this theoretical knowledge, this is what you measure, it cannot be just by chance. Of course, if you don't have this knowledge, you can always find correlations, but here you are predicting the correlation, which I think is a very, very important point in the game. So the first transition that has been used are alkali doublets. So you just have a doublet transition here, like in silicium-4. And in this case, the delta lambda between the two lines over lambda is just scaling as alpha squared. And it has been used by different telescopes, so the VLT in Chile and the Keck telescope in Hawaii. And you see by different number of systems, but basically, you see that there is no variation of the fine structure constant at the level of 10 to the minus 5 using this kind of techniques. And then the idea, which was a very innovative idea by John Webb and collaborators at the end of the 90s, was to take into account this fact. I mean, actually, this was part of their work, I mean, to realize that the lines were moving and you can compute these things. They work with atomic physicists, actually, to get these numbers. And once you have this knowledge, then you can say, okay, let us just not only use a doublet, but let's try to use many transitions. Because if we have this extra information, maybe we can improve our technique. So this is what they did, and so they compute this number here, so this is the frequency of the transition and how sensitive it is to alpha, and this is what I showed you just before. And basically the first result, they just use that using 30 absorption system with magnesium and iron 2. The reason is that magnesium is almost insensitive to a change of alpha, so they use that as what they call an anchor. And basically, you compare everything to magnesium. You know it's slightly varying. So if you see something, it will be due to the fact that these elements have more sensitivity to a change of the fine structure constant. So they use this Keck telescope. They have a resolution of 45,000. And you see what was surprising here, and they were using 143 system of absorption, is they get this constraint. And you see zero is not lying in this interval. So that was the basic. So this is the result from 2004. And this can be estimated to be a 5 sigma detection. So from there, and this is why the field starts to be very lively, is that some people came with this observation that actually you have a 5 sigma detection of the fact that at a redshift somewhere between 2 and 4, the fine structure constant was smaller than it is today. If this is true, it means that we have to go back to all what we know in physics. We know there are new interactions. We know that GR is not there, and we have to extend general relativity. So it's a very important motivation to go and see whether this is the correct result or whether there is a problem with this observation. And this has been a debate for about 10 years. And what has to be done is to list all the sources of uncertainty. Some can come from the observations. Some can come from the modelization of the system. For instance, imagine you have some magnetic field in the clouds. Well, if you have atom in a magnetic field, there will be a small shift of the energy levels. If you have differential velocities, there will be differential Doppler shifts. And if you are not able to correct that well enough, then maybe you will mimic this effect. So all these effects were studied and by numerical simulation, and it was shown that none of them can reproduce the result, which was a nice point, until it was understood, and this is mostly the work of Kisoliv in Minneapolis, that one important thing is the isotopic abundance of magnesium 2. So magnesium, you come with different isotopes, 24, 25, and 26. And we assume that this ratio is the one that we have on Earth today. But we know that it's evolving, because if you go to higher redshift, you expect this, that there is a correlation between this isotopic ratio and metallicity. So if metallicity is smaller at higher redshift, it shouldn't be the same as today. So it was shown that, well, if this could be an explanation that we don't control this isotopic ratio, and they proposed a way to get this ratio low enough so that you can explain this observation without a variation of the fine structure constant. The point is that instead of what was used, you need this value of 0.62 instead of the one that was used. But if you do that, you have to explain how you get this isotopic ratio, which means that you have to change something to stellar physics for some kind of objects. They managed to do that by changing the physics of giants, so red giants, which are this typical mass. But if you do that, well, you will also process different chemical elements like phosphor, silicium, and aluminium. So in principle, if you are going and look, you can check whether this is a valid explanation, which we are not able to do right now. But in principle, this is something that can be done. So this is an explanation to go around it. And you see, either you live with physics beyond standard physics, or you will have to say that the way we understand the stellar dynamics is not the correct one, because we have this kind of non-standard stellar evolution. So this is the balance today, but at least we have an explanation which could be considered as based on standard physics in terms of theoretical physics. The second thing you should do is to go to another telescope with another team and try to redo the same kind of observation. And this is done by, in particular, my colleague Patrick Petitjean from the Institute of d'Astrophysique de Paris and Anand Sriyanand from UCA in India. And because they knew about this result, they say, okay, let's try to be as clean as we can. We just select lines which allow us to make very precise and clean measurements. So instead of 143 systems, they will have an analysis which is based just only on 23 systems. So you will get a larger statistical error bars, but smaller systematics, at least you hope. So this is what they did with another telescope. So if you had some systematic effect due to the telescope itself, then it should be removed. And they use this telescope, the VLT telescope in Chile. And you see what they got is this constraint, which is compatible with zero variations. So then it started a huge debate, which is actually not finished. But the good point is that now the two teams are working together, and there is a series of observations at the VLT with 37 nights of observation, and they are making a common analysis, and hopefully in 1 year or two, we'll know whether they have detected some flaw in one of the two analyses, and I think we will progress. I mean, this is the only way. They have been fighting together, and so it's, I'm not part of the analysis, so I don't want to say much about who is right, who is wrong, but they have been fighting together, but now they have a common large program at the VLT. reality, and I think this is a good evolution of the field. So hopefully in 1 or 2 years we may know whether we have to worry about the fine structure constant, or whether it was just some problems that it's maybe that there is a systematic effect that we don't think of. I mean, and this is always a problem. You were saying you have to kill all the suspects, and this is what is difficult when you do astrophysics. Sometimes you don't even know what is the source of the systematic, so you cannot even test whether it has to be taken into account. So the other evolution, which I think was realized by these Australian astronomers, was the following. This is a representation of the sky. So every point here is a direction in the sky. And these points and square, they are the different observations. So here they plotted the observation by both the Keck telescope and the VLT, triangle, by the VLT alone, which is in Chile, so it's south hemisphere, and the Keck telescope, which is in Hawaii, so more northern hemisphere. And the larger the symbol, the larger the deviation from zero. And so then you have this map, and you can ask yourself whether the distribution is isotropic. And actually what they found is that, well, two things can be reconciled. If instead of having just a pure time variation, you allow for a spatial variation, and at least you have this kind of dipole in the fine structure constant. So this is a logical possibility. The question is whether it makes sense. Okay, so I will say a word on that, because we can now put constraint on this kind of ideas using the recent result of the Planck satellite. So I'll just come back on this. So then the next evolution is to use all other kind of transitions, because the dependence on the fundamental constant will be different. And if you do that, you can have also remove some systematics. And today there is a whole list of transitions which have been used. And I don't want to come into the details, but you see you have some molecular transitions and so on and so on. And all these things we are able to measure with different techniques. And we have constraint on all these things. So this is coming from my review. You have all the systems here and the constraint you get. And you see none of them is showing a deviation from zero. These are a different redshift using different kind of transitions. So this is the only observation which makes us worry, but it's still there and we have to understand it. So just to tell us, the project I was talking about is this Codex telescope. And you see the resolution we hope to reach is 150,000. Which means that the expected accuracy on the fine structure constant and this mu parameter should be 10 to the minus 8. So if we reach there, there is a 10 to the minus 5 effect. You should see it like the nose in the figure of your face, in the middle of your face. So that's a very interesting development. But this should be on a 20-year scale, so we will all be retired by then. But okay. Okay, so this is so far atomic physics, and I want to come to nuclear physics, and this is this Oklo phenomenon. I don't know whether you know, but Oklo, it's a very nice piece of physics, I guess. So Oklo is a town. It's a town in Gabon. So you see you have Africa here, George is living somewhere here, and Gabon is somewhere here. Okay, and in Gabon you have this town Oklo, and in Oklo it was discovered in the 70s, a uranium mine. It was discovered by the French Atomic Energy Center, and the reason was that we had this nuclear program in France, and we have to find uranium. So they found uranium there in the 70s. And it was understood that, well, at first it was realized that if you take the uranium in this mine, you know that it comes in different isotopes, uranium-238 and 235. And only one of them is really used, and I will come back on that, useful to make a nuclear reactor. And in this mine, it was depleted. And if you compare to any mine on Earth, it was depleted, and no one understood why. And actually, at the beginning, there is a huge story. It's almost, again, a spy story, because it was a Cold War, and it was thought that maybe the Russians came here to do nuclear experiments. And there is, I met one of the guys working on these things in the 70s, and he told me a story which has never been published about analysis, trying to see whether that was a proof that extraterrestrial people would have come to the Earth before, and so on and so on, until physics is useful to show that, well, if you analyze everything you know about physics, you can convince yourself that in Oklo there was a natural nuclear reactor that operated 2 billion years ago during a time scale of 200,000 years. So the question is, how come is it possible? I mean, if you know how difficult it is to construct a nuclear reactor today on Earth, how come just like by chance you have a nuclear reactor working like that? I mean, that could be a good exercise for entropic things. I mean, just we discover a natural nuclear reactor, how likely is that? And some people will tell you, oh, this is a proof of design. And I will show you that you don't need design, just nature is doing that for you. Yeah, the reason is the following, is that today, if you go to a mine, as I told you before, there is uranium-238 and 235. What you need is 235. But 235 is just 0.7% of what of the total uranium you get. Okay, so that is what we know. This is geology. What also we know from nuclear physics is that both uranium-235 and 238, they decay. And they have lifetime. We can measure the lifetime. But the lifetime is different. So if the lifetime is different, this ratio will depend on time. If you go backward in time, you can predict what was the ratio between uranium-235 and 238. So 235 is longer lived than 238. So if you go backward in time, you'd get more 235. If you go 2 billion years ago, well, the isotopic ratio is 3%. And 3% is what is the critical density. This is the ratio you need for having a nuclear reactor to work. So just because the two decay rates are different, well, if you were living 2 billion years ago, you don't need to enrich your uranium. You just take your uranium from the mine, put it in the reactor, it works. Then this is the first point. It was the mineral uranium was naturally enriched in uranium-235. Then you start to have this nuclear reaction. You produce neutrons. They are thermal neutrons. You need to slow them down. If you don't slow them down, they will be too high energy and they cannot contribute to the chain reaction. Usually what you use water to do that in the nuclear reactor, and there was water flowing in the mine. So water plays the role of the moderator. You need this neutron to be free for further reaction, so you don't need them to be absorbed by other elements, and you can show that, and geophysics tells you that, well, in this place, the abundance of neutron absorber was very small. And then the last thing is you need the room where this thing is happening to be larger than the mean free pass. If it's the case, then you will have it one reaction in average for each neutron. And this is the case. You measure the size of the room, you know what is the mean free pass, and it works. So you have all these four conditions, and it starts to produce neutrons, and you will have this chain reaction. It will not be like exploding. It will be like very low, and you will have water. The water may be like just boiling water or just to take a bath for dinosaurs, I don't know. But no, there was no dinosaur at the time, even though. But so you just have hot water, and that's it. And this is just physics at work. You don't need anything. And so now you can analyze that and say, well, if I discover that, is it a proof of design, for instance? I mean, that could be a nice question for this kind of reasoning that you are doing with the entropic principle. Okay, so if you do that now, how can you do that to say something on the fundamental constant? I will be very short. So one of the observations concerns this samarium nuclei. So the samarium nuclei, again, come with two isotopes, samarium-149 and 150. And if you go to any mine, you will see that the isotopic ratio between these two is 0.9, and it's 0.02, I think, in this mine. And the reason is that there is a resonant transition absorption of a neutron by samarium for this reaction. And the reason, the energy of the resonance you see is very small. It's almost 0.1 eV. So what you can do, you know that there is this reaction. You can measure from the mine. Estimate what is the cross-section average on the temperature, and this is a function of the resonance energy, and this is something you measure in your mind. Then now you have to understand to make a model of the samarium nuclei to see how this cross-section depends on the change of the resonance energy. It's a difficult computation. It has been attempted by different people, in particular Thibaut Daimour and Freeman Dyson. They were the first to make something which was very robust. But the first estimate was done by this Russian nuclear physicist, Schleierter, and actually he was working with a security agent in the Chernobyl nuclear reactor at some stage. And if you do that, you see that the sensibility is order of 1 MeV. So you see, if this is 1 MeV, the sensitivity is of order of 1 MeV, and basically you cannot allow for a change which is more than 0.1 eV, otherwise your resonance will not be there. You get that just the ratio of these two numbers, sensitivity about the value of the energy resonance you measure today, is 10 to the minus 7. So you expect that because it's working, you should, because you have this depletion here, the alpha should not vary by typical order of 10 to the minus 7. So if you do a better analysis, well, this is what you get. I mean, you have this constraint which is compatible with this just end-waving argument. And of course, to get this number, there is a lot of nuclear physics to model the nuclei. But you see that on this time scale, so 2 billion years, it has not varied by more than 10 to the minus 7. So it's a very important fact because, of course, it's not localized at the same position, but it's a redshift of, let's say, 0.17. And if you compare it to this 10 to the minus 5 at a redshift of 2, well, you start to be worried. Can I construct model for which I have this 10 to the minus 5 on a, let's say, 10 gigahertz time scale, where I have just 10 to the minus 7 on a 2 gigahertz? Then you are starting to construct and see whether models will work or not. Okay, then the same kind of thing is happening with Big Bang nuclear studies. So now we are back like 1 second to a couple of minutes after the Big Bang. So the universe is very hot. We just have, let's say, 1 second after the Big Bang, we just have very few elements in the universe. We have neutrons and protons, and we have neutrinos, photons, and electrons and positrons, and that's it. And you would like, you have nuclear reactions, and the neutrons and protons, they are in equilibrium but the weak interaction. And the universe cooled down, you'll try it by this nuclear reaction. In principle, you can produce deuterium. But deuterium is really lightly bound, so it's very fragile. And because you are in a thermal bath, the universe is so hot that each time you form deuterium, you photoionize deuterium. So the universe will cool down. At some stage, the weak interaction will freeze, which means that actually there won't be any equilibrium between neutron and proton. So the neutron will decay into protons. So if you wait too long enough, then you don't have even neutrons. So if you have to wait too long to form deuterium, because neutrons are just stable inside nuclei and not as free neutrons, then you can imagine scenarios in which all neutrons have disappeared, you just have left with protons and electrons, and that's bad for doing chemistry. Luckily, well, we start to do deuterium, and then when you have started to do deuterium, with all these series of nuclear reactions, you can do tritium, helium-4, and then to lighter element. But basically, because this is lightly bound, you will go to a nuclei which is more bound than helium and deuterium, and basically most of the matter will lie either in helium or in protons. There won't be any free neutrons. All neutrons will be mostly in helium, and you will be trace of the other elements. So now you know how to compute this. This is nuclear physics at the MeV scale, so you know everything about this. Actually, today we have, with my collaborators in IAP, Elisabeth Vangioni and Alain Koch, we have a network of nuclear reactions for BBN with 400 nuclear reactions, not just like these 12 main that you need to make the standard predictions. We have 400. And then you can start to say, what's happening if we change a little bit the property of the nuclear physics? What's happening? So here is what we observe today. So we will base basically on the observation of lithium, tritium, deuterium, and helium. And these are the theoretical prediction in the standard framework, assuming that nuclear physics is the one we know on Earth today. These are the observation, and this is the constraint on the ratio between number of photons and number of baryons coming from WMAP and Planck. And you see, we have a very good consistency for helium, deuterium, and tritium. There is this lithium problem, which I won't discuss here. It's endless. Okay, so what should we do? Well, basically, if we want to estimate the number, the abundance of helium, we have to know what is the ratio between neutron and proton at the time we start to form nuclei. And you see, if I just start by a system in which neutron and proton are at equilibrium, there is a freeze-out of the weak interaction. So basically, the ratio between the two at the freeze-out depends on the difference of mass between the mass of the neutron and mass of the proton. And then there is the decay of the proton between the time the weak interaction freezes and the time you start to form nuclei. So they will decay, so this abundance will drop, and this is the lifetime of the neutron. So if this number is too large or too small, for instance, then all your neutron will disappear very fast from your universe. And then you need to know when this happened. There is the temperature of the freeze-out, and this comes from the balance between, I mean, this is the Friedmann equation. So here you have the density of radiation, and this is the Hubble expansion rate. So basically, this time is determined by the time at which the nuclear reaction rate is equal to the expansion rate. It's an n-wavy argument. What you have to do is to solve Boltzmann equation out of equilibrium, but you get the correct numbers if you do this analysis. And then you have two bodies reactions. They are charged particles. So if you want to have protons, you have to beat a Coulomb barrier. So this Coulomb barrier will depend also, again, on the fine structure constant and ratio of the mass of the electron and mass of the proton. So all the fundamental constants you know will enter this game. And if you make the list of which are the important fundamental constants, you tell us that you need to know the gravitational constant, the fine Schwarzschild constant, the neutron, the lifetime of the neutron, mass of the electron, the difference between mass of the neutron and mass of the proton, the binding energy of the deuterium, because this is a bottleneck of, I mean, you don't start, I mean, if the deuterium had a larger binding energy, you can start to form more deuterium. And then all the cross sections. These are the new parameters. And then you have all the cosmological parameters. You need to know about the number of neutrinos, about the value of the Hubble parameter, about the density of radiation. But these are the standard parameters we measure in cosmology. So now we can try to see what are the important parameters. And the first thing to do is just to take your code, you vary this parameter, and you see which one is sensitive to your analysis. So this is what we did some years ago. And you see we have here the variation. So these curves, therefore, we vary independently the mass of the electron, the binding energy of the deuterium, difference of mass between neutron and proton, and the lifetime of the neutron. And what is important here is that basically the most sensitive quantity is the variation of the binding energy. But you see, if I start to vary the binding energy, I have to worry because this is coming from some nuclear physics. It may be that when I vary this, I mean, of course, this will vary and this will vary together because the underlying physics is the same. So you have to try to make there. They should be expressed in terms of the same fundamental constant. So the first thing you get is that, well, from observation, you get this bound on this parameter. And what is interesting, if you look at it here, you see it's everything is compatible, but inside this box, there is a smaller box, this one, the blue one. You are still compatible with observation of deuterium and helium, but you see, you start to be compatible with lithium. So if we push the thing, which I don't want because this was in 2006 and the data have evolved, I mean, this is narrow, so now I don't think it still holds. But at the time, it was possible to argue that the problem with lithium can be resolved by a variation of the fundamental constant. So that's also what you tried, I mean, what you have to keep in mind. So if I want to do, and that I won't detail, but I have to ask myself how these quantities that I can constrain depend on other parameters. And basically, you can do a model of QCD, and you will be able to relate the variation of this quantity to the variation of the X-VEV, the Yukawa coupling, and the fine Schwarzschild constant. And then you can work out in different models. Grand unified theories, there are relations between these quantities. And the more theoretical hypotheses you have, the less parameter you have. So you have a balance of making no hypotheses and having a lot of parameters, or having strong hypotheses on the unification and less parameters. So we played both to see whether it's sensitive. So I don't want to describe that in all detail, but basically this is what you have to do. But you see you have this R parameter here, and there is a factor 2 or 3 on the value of these parameters according to what we know on the physics today. Okay, so again, there are some limitations about this. The last point is that, well, if you vary the constant, you see you don't have like elements with 5, like you don't see helium 5 or lithium 5 here, and you don't see beryllium 8. And beryllium 8 is very important because if I want to look to carbon, I should go through beryllium 8, and then beryllium 8 plus helium 4 will give me carbon. And this is one of the reasons you have very low carbon. One thing we try to do, just also for the entropic argument, we try to say, okay, let's try to vary the constant so that A equal 5 and A equal 8 nuclei are stable. Imagine like I change the fundamental constant so that beryllium 8 is constant. Can I produce a lot of carbon during BBN? Because if it's the case, then I've produced like, I don't know, an abundance of 10 to the minus 8 of carbon during BBN. So maybe life can start much earlier. I don't have to wait for population 3 stars to produce carbon and so on. And actually, you can show that even if you vary a lot the fundamental constant and you have A equal 5 and A equal 8, which are stable, you don't produce a large amount of carbon. So this is a very interesting result, is that, I mean, these possibilities to go around, you know, this production of carbon by population 3 stars, we cannot solve it by varying the fundamental constant during BBN. You have all seen this map. This is the map by Planck of the CMB sky. And you have a lot of information in this map. And one important process is the way recombination is working. So this is proton plus electron is giving hydrogen. It's working in equilibrium. And the reaction rate is basically given by the Thomson scattering section and the density of electrons. This is an out-of-equilibrium process, and it requires to solve a Boltzmann equation. But in principle, you see, there is the way the fundamental constant will enter this parameter. So it will change the way we have recombination. Just to give you a flavor, so you have different processes that you have to take into account. They will both, they will all depend on G alpha and the mass of the electron. And this is what happened on the history of recombination if you vary alpha by 5% and mass of the electron by 5%. And you see, you have a small shift. The question is, can we use that shift to put constraint on their variation? So what you usually use is, and what is observed by Planck and WMAP, is the angular power spectrum. So this is the mean power on a given angular scale. And this is what we observe today. So you see, we have very strong constraint here. And this is the effect of a 5% change on alpha, all other cosmological parameters being equal. So you see, I mean, if you have this variation, look at the error bars here, you should be able to say something. And you have the same thing on the polarization. So this is the temperature E polarization correlation. And this is the same for the EE polarization. So let's try to use this thing. So you do that, you put that in your CMB code, you vary all parameters, and you realize that it was done by WMAP, and you get this huge degeneracy between the fine structure constant and the Hubble parameters. You can be anywhere here. Now, if we use the Planck data, we just shrink this to this small thing here. And it took us a long time to understand why, and I'd like to tell you why. So you can do that with all parameters, and you can show that actually we go very fast. But with Planck, we basically improved the constraint that was obtained by WMAP by a factor of about 5. So the point is that I told you it depends on alpha and mass of the electron. And this is what you get with MAP, and you have this degeneracy, and that you can understand. Because if you look at the Thomson scattering cross-section, there is this degeneracy. And with Planck, what you see here is that we get almost independent constraint on alpha and mass of the electron. How come is it possible? And to do that, so it was a very nice work and done by Sylvia Galli at the Institute. She's a postdoc in the Planck team. I asked her, okay, what we have to do is that we have taken all the dependence on the fundamental constant on all the processes. But what happens if you take them one by one, just to see what's happening? So this is what happens if you change the hydrogen binding energy. This is what changes if you just change the Lyman alpha binding energy, and then you put both of them, so this is the purple line, and then you add what happened when you change the dependence in alpha in the Thomson cross-section, and so on and so on, and when you have all terms. And you do that for alpha, and you do that for mass of the electron. And you see this is almost the same, until you reach very high multiple, very small angular scales. And when you go to small angular scale, you see there is a difference here on the amplitude of the curves. And it's just because Planck is able to give data point to very high multiples that you are able to break this degeneracy. So again, it's because you have more observational information that you will break the degeneracy that you were not able to break before. Okay, so I'm finished. So the oil argument, maybe if you want to ask questions about this, or we just stop here. And I will just put a conclusion, which is the same plot. It's what we knew and what we know today and what we are going to know. So this is the relative variation that we are allowed. We are now at the 10 to the minus 3, both with BBN and CMB for almost all constant. We were at 10 to the minus 2 10 years ago. And we have reached 10 to the minus 5 with Quasar. We hope to reach 10 to the minus 7, 10 to the minus 8. So you see, on the time scale and length scale of the observable universe, there is really little room for a variation of fundamental constant, except this observation at the level of 10 to the minus 5 somewhere here in the space-time diagram. So is it real? If yes, well, this is very important. If no, then it will decay away by future observations. So, thank you.